We'll go ahead and get started here just to be mindful of everyone's time. Hello, everyone. My name is Jordan Vaughn, and I work with the National Crime Prevention Council. Welcome to our Reducing Violent Crime webinar. This is our second installment of this webinar series, and this one will be more so centered around community engagement. So just to give you all a little bit of back information, in conjunction with the Justice Department's Bureau of Justice Assistance, we have launched our Reducing Violent Crime campaign. This is a full-blown educational campaign, and we have launched a brand new public service announcement that you will all see in a second, as well as billboards, radio ads, social media ads, and there's even an email from a rough portion of this campaign. You can find that located at ncpc.org/preventviolentcrime, and you'll be able to see how you can go ahead and email with McGruff yourself. Now, what this campaign is, we understand that violent crime is on the rise around the country, and there are a lot of people that do not feel safe in their neighborhoods. This is not a good feeling, and nobody wants to feel unsafe. And so we have launched this campaign to kind of give you all tools and that empowerment to get involved in your community and build it to be the safe environment that you want it to be. So this effort does have to come from both sides. We recognize that this involves a joint effort between law enforcement and community members alike. And that is why today I have invited Captain Aprille Moore and a colleague that she works with, Septima Riley. I will let them introduce themselves in just a second. But for now, I wanted to show you all our public service announcement. And you might see a familiar face on there. So.
This is a good neighborhood. This is a good neighborhood. A good place to raise your kids.
Sorry,
one second.
You have your phone?
I don't have your
number, but that's not explained.
This is a good neighborhood. A good place to raise your kids. Yes, there's some crime. And unfortunately, some people in this neighborhood don't trust the police. What has to happen? The police should be reaching out to this community, and the community should be reaching out to the police. That's the way to make this a safer place. The good news? This police department is reaching out to the community. We really are, and the community is doing its part. We're listening to each other. We're building partnerships. This is what should be happening all across the country. That's how we get to where we can all finally celebrate safe communities. Get involved.
Start the conversation and help stop crime. To learn the five things you can do, go to ncpc.org/preventviolentcrime.
Awesome. So, Captain Moore, I have to ask, are you still with the sheriff's office, or have you signed your contract with Hollywood at this point?
I'm still with the sheriff's office.
All right. So like I said before, we have invited Captain Aprille Moore here. She was the face of our public service announcement and did an absolute wonderful job. And the reason I wanted to invite you here today is because you have that dual perspective of being in law enforcement, but you're also highly involved with your community. So go ahead, give yourself a little introduction, and then we'll get to Septima as well.
As she stated, I am Captain Aprille Moore, and I am a captain with the Fulton County Sheriff's Office here in Atlanta, Georgia, under the leadership of Sheriff Pat Labatt, who is the 28th Sheriff of Fulton County. And I have worked in law enforcement for approximately 17 years now. I currently command our community engagement unit, which is right in line with everything else that I do, because outside of work, I'm heavily involved in several organizations, from sorority to Junior League to Hands on Atlanta, just several organizations that I'm involved with. I'm a mother of two boys who are active as well. And I truly just really enjoy being involved with community. So the fact that I get to work in law enforcement and do the things that I love in the community every day is just an absolute pleasure for me all the time. So that's just a little bit about me.
Awesome. And Septima.
Thank you. I'm Septima Riley. I am the clinical director at YouthSpark, and we are based here in Fulton County. And that is where we have had the pleasure of working with Captain Moore here.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, just to get things started, I have a couple of questions prepared for you guys, but to any of the attendees, if you have any questions for either of these beautiful women here today, please feel free to put them in the Q&A section, and my colleague who is off video but is monitoring that chat will let us know and we'll get those answered for you guys. So the first question I have for you is, when you're engaging with the community, what would you say is the most important aspect of that engagement?
I think just recognizing that people are people. I think being in law enforcement, a lot of times we see situations on a constant basis, and sometimes you can become a little desensitized because you see the same thing every day, but we have to remain grounded and know that everyone is different. Everyone experiences things, even though it may be the same situation, everybody's way of handling stress is different. So I think the biggest thing is just remembering that people are human, and people may do bad things, but that doesn't necessarily make them bad people, and just to treat them accordingly.
Mm-hmm. So do you have anything to add?
I'm going to keep off of mute so that I don't have to keep searching for it. But no, I agree. I think Captain Moore hit the nail on the head. It's just more than anything, remembering that we're all human beings trying to figure this thing out every day. And so when we enter the work with that idea, helps us to empathize with everyone we interact with.
Awesome. And Captain Moore, this question is a little bit more so for you, but as a law enforcement officer, what do you think that piece of community engagement does for you and how you serve your community when you're in uniform?
I think when people see me, number one, most people don't assume. They're like, you work in law enforcement. They're like, how old are you? Are you even old enough to be doing this? I say thank you for making me feel so young. But seriously, though, I think that my personality and being able to engage with folks really changes their perspective about law enforcement, makes them a little more comfortable having a conversation about some of the things that are going on in their community. And I am always open to ideas and bringing those to decision makers and talking about ways that we can change what is happening in people's communities. But I definitely see it as an opportunity to change the narrative. That's one thing that I'm always looking at, because when I'm in uniform, I don't just represent my sheriff's office, I represent law enforcement nationwide, because whatever happens here could impact what happens in other cities and other states. So I'm always mindful of how I interact with people and treat them how I would want to be treated or I would want my children to be treated.
Awesome. Well, this one is definitely for both of you. So like I said before, this campaign is about encouraging both law enforcement and community members to begin that engagement with each other. So what would you say to community members to empower them to take that step of going to build those bridges with law enforcement?
One thing I would say is going to your local police department or sheriff's office just to get to know the people that are there. Often what I've found, especially if you have a family member that has maybe a mental health issue or other, crisis that they may experience on either acute or chronic basis, but letting local law enforcement know about that kind of prepares them to be able to deal with it, because a lot of us do receive training that prepares us to deal with individuals that are having acute mental health issues, or if someone has experienced a very tragic incident and how to de-escalate those situations. But we are also tasked with trying to ensure that everyone is safe at the same time during that incident. So I would say, one, take the opportunity to get to learn your local law enforcement officers outside of, in a non-enforcement way. So don't let it be the only time that you meet this law enforcement officer is when something bad is going on or you need their help, but just getting to learn who they are in that community. And I think that is helpful because that begins to build a bridge. And, one of my favorite quotes is, discipline without relationship breeds resentment. So if I'm not, active in this community and learning who you are, then it makes it difficult for me to communicate with you. But if we have a relationship, it's a two-way street and we're able to have that conversation and feel comfortable about give and take and ensuring that we're all walking towards the same goal.
Awesome. And so, team, I'd love to hear your perspective as well from that more so community engagement side.
Yeah, I think one way to get involved is local meetings, you know, especially commissioners meetings. I think it's really important for us to recognize that a lot of the decisions that are made for our communities, the law enforcement officers and departments are working hand in hand with our leaders as well. And so being able to have citizens show up to voice their concerns and be able to work together, I think that was one of the first things that, you know, really helped me understand, like, hey, I want to see these things happening, but how can I get engaged and get an understanding of what's coming down the pipeline? A lot of times we find out about things after it's already implemented, and then it's like, well, why did this happen? You know, and so being a bit more proactive and getting engaged and finding out what's happening. And like Captain Moore said, building those relationships on the front end, I think make a huge difference. And it also helps us to understand what's available in our communities as far as mental health services. And so, you know, whether it's a family member, whether it's a neighbor, when we all pull together to work together and use the resources that we have in place, we can scratch each other's back and be there for one another.
Awesome. And so, Tina, I just want to be able to send this to the general chat for everyone to see. What are some of those events that are happening for people to be proactive? You mentioned, what was the one you just said?
So the local commissioners meetings, you have like zoning meetings, the tax commissioner meetings you can attend, town hall meetings are available, and that kind of, you know, gives you a general idea of what's happening in your community. And our commissioners, you know, they're available. So for some of us, you know, we're prepping for campaign season. So you're going to, you'll see, you know, individuals in the community, but they're accessible, you know, whether it's via email or phone. And so it's a two-way street, you know, with them ensuring that they're in the community, but also the community reaching out to say, hey, you know, let's have a conversation about, you know, what are your plans for the community and how can we assist, how can we be present, but also being able to voice those concerns and requests on what you want to see in your community as well. We're all here to work together. So it's just so much more beneficial when you have that voice in the community as to what's needed.
Mm-hmm. I love that. So Captain Moore, I actually wanted to touch on something that you said earlier about the discipline without relationship builds resentment. So in a community that maybe say has a bit more resentment build up than others, what do you think are the steps for community members and law enforcement alike to take to kind of thaw that relationship and start building the bridge instead?
Number one, you have to have people that are willing to have a conversation. I think that times when there is hurt, anger, frustration, and a lot of other emotions behind some, you know, and with good reason in a lot of instances, on both sides, I think you have to have people that are willing to come in and have a conversation and not just make decisions independent of each other. I think, and some people, I have a lot of quotes about everything, but when you look at, if you don't have a seat at the table, then you're likely on the menu, right? So if you are having law enforcement officers coming together to have discussions about what can we do in this community and coming up with these ideas, but don't actually have community members present to talk about what it is that's actually happening and what's going on in their community that needs to be changed in terms of relationship, then you may not get as much buy-in from the community. And on the same side, when you have community members that feel a way about how law enforcement officers are coming in the community, what they're doing, but they're saying, hey, we're going to protest or we're going to ask, make these demands, but haven't really had a conversation with the local law enforcement officials to kind of see what this looks like. Why is this happening? And I think when you have those conversations, people have a little bit more information to be able to make educated decisions about what that plan looks like for that specific community moving forward.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Well, to everyone, I have about one or two more questions for our guests today. So please feel free to send those again to the chat or to the Q&A function. But my other question for you guys is, what kind of programming do you think community members want to see, or kind of what are those easier first steps to take in terms of events and ways that they can get the community engaged to want to go together to law enforcement to start the conversation?
I'll start. So one of the programs that I think, or one of the biggest things I think is youth programs, anything dealing with youth, because we know that they are our future. They are the future leaders of our cities, of our counties, of our states. And building that relationship starts there, because a lot of times when, if a parent has an issue with law enforcement, then that is usually that talk is passed on to their child, and they build a certain view about law enforcement, which I certainly understand that there are conversations that parents have to have with their children, because I have two children of my own and have had to have conversations with them. And understanding that, you also have to be thoughtful about what that means for them when they may or may not have had those experiences, but you also may want to protect them in a way, not knowing what happens when they go out in the world. So I think being involved in any youth programs, it would be, that would be the biggest start. I get maybe 5 calls a week from parents about, you know, kids that are just struggling right now and really wanting someone from law enforcement to support them. And a lot of times the kids are very open to us being there with them because they enjoy the attention. They enjoy a lot of the things that we do, but, you know, may not necessarily know how to communicate that in a way that doesn't come off as, you know, them trying to be disrespectful or having behavioral issues or something along those lines. I think also to the Septima being on here, we work with YouthSpark. They have kids that go through their program and see us and get to know us and recognize that even though they may be there for a law enforcement or a court related issue, that you can have non-enforcement contact with a law enforcement officer. So I think anything dealing with youth or any community is really what is going to get us there.
That was actually in my notes. So, just as a little bit of a background, I actually met Captain Moore through another organization I'm a part of, National Association of Black Social Workers. And we were actually doing this exact thing. Like, how do we support our local law enforcement as well as our communities? How do we bridge the gap? And she was very instrumental there. So when I came on board with YouthSpark and they're like, oh, we have a community partner. Like, I was trying to plan some events. They're like, oh, we already have a community partner. And so finally, I found out as Captain Moore, and I was like, oh, we're in good hands. So I know she's going to take care of us. And so after I came on with YouthSpark full time, one of the first events that Captain Moore spearheaded was for Valentine's Day. And so just to give you guys an idea, we talk about events, I think, in general, but an actual example is they had meals catered for our youth. They decorated our center. Our executive director, Jennifer Swain, was like, it looks like Cupid just came in here and assaulted the center. Like, it was hearts everywhere. It was balloons everywhere. The kids were super excited. We were excited. It was just, you know, as soon as you walked in the center, you saw the decor, you saw their smiling faces, and they genuinely came in with the mindset and the position of how can we serve? How can we serve? How can we show up for the youth? And I think that in and of itself, and we had conversations, our executive team had conversations with Captain Moore about some of our youth having trauma and or preconceived notions about law enforcement. So they approached them with that in mind and just being there to serve, being there to help and being available. And so I think that it's relationship building with anyone or any population. It's going to be relationship building and just showing up. So even some of our youth who walked in the center, like, y'all, you know, just in their language, they're like, y'all got 12 in here, you know? And so we're like, and so they came in, they're like, oh, that lady's really nice. Or that was really sweet of them. And we explained, like, they brought dinner for you guys. And it's like, really, they did that for us? And so that's how those conversations begin. You know, they're coming in with their own experiences or their own ideas of how it's going to go. And then we have beautiful opportunities like that and several others. Captain Moore has been involved with YouthSpark for several years and has done many trainings and events with us, but it's continuing that relationship, I think, with any population.
Awesome. And I love that you bring up the youth in that, because just thinking about the timing of where our country is with COVID and everything, I think a lot of people, especially the kids, are looking for those real and true connections. And so it is a great time to capitalize on that. We all just want a little bit of community building around us. All right, so we've had a couple of questions come in. So one of them is, how can we find the right balance between community leaders and law, how can the right balance between community leaders and law enforcement impact a community? And why do you think that's such a struggle right now?
Well, number one, I would say trying to find that right balance is always going to depend on the community, you know, and what has happened in that community to see what that balance looks like. I think it would be impactful to get the right balance, because once you do, that creates a beautiful relationship. I think on a program that I recently went through called Project Understanding through the American Jewish Committee, and it's through the Black Jewish Coalition, and they specifically take members of the Black community and the Jewish community to kind of have conversations. And the way the program is set up, it really promotes candid conversations about things that you otherwise might not necessarily, you know, feel comfortable talking about. But sometimes you have to be uncomfortable in the conversation. Sometimes you do have to look at what you're doing and what systemic issues may be present. And if everyone is willing to recognize that there's a level of vulnerability that comes with being a part of that process and be willing to lean into that, that is what is going to create that space for change.
Awesome. Anything to add, Septima?
Yeah, I think the balance also comes with, as we've said several times, building that relationship. But in part of that is empowering our community members to understand that their voices are important, that it's their community. And so, you know, when people feel like they have some control over what's happening, you can see that shift as well. So I think them being advised on ways that they can get involved and, you know, how important their voice is at the table, because, you know, everything that we do is going to depend on what's important to that particular community. So.
Awesome.
And I actually wanted to follow up on that too. I was listening to Septima talk. A lot of the issues that we see that happen in law enforcement aren't necessarily born out of, because nobody wakes up and just says every day, I want to be a criminal, or nobody's in high school like, you know, this is what mm-hmm. I want mm-hmm. with life. And we really have to look outside of what's going on with law enforcement and look at a lot of the other socioeconomic issues that are impacting people. You know, when you look at lack of access to healthcare, lack of access to education, you know, when people are economically disadvantaged, a lot of times if people are out stealing or doing these things, it's for survival. So what do we do to address those issues that are, you know, these social issues that are at the crux of why people are being involved in these types of incidents? While I do recognize the role that law enforcement plays, it's a lot more community partners and industries that have to have a seat at the table to have that conversation and move it forward.
Exactly. And that's one of the things about the crime prevention world as a whole, is that it is more than just law enforcement. But we do have about 5 minutes left. So kind of on that same vein of crime prevention, what does crime prevention mean to both of you? And how has that definition of it changed over the years?
I would say crime prevention for me is just taking an active role in ensuring that community members are holding each other accountable. Because I think about, I grew up in an old neighborhood, you know, I grew up around my grandmother, and it was nothing if I was doing something I wasn't supposed to be doing. If my grandmother didn't whoop me, my grandma's neighbor would whoop me, or one of my other, like, everyone took an active role in what was going on in the community. And that's what it really takes. And I think a lot of times people have kind of, you know, said, hey, you know, that's not my problem, or that's not in my house, or, you know, people take an approach of just being kind of condescending with people. Everybody's going through things. And I think when we look at crime prevention, it's really an active role of everybody in the community, not just looking at law enforcement officers to bear that community burden. It's everyone taking an active role to stop these things that are going on in our communities.
Absolutely. And I think now, especially, you know, with us having been in a pandemic for the last couple of years, we're just starting to scratch the surface as to how this has truly impacted our youth as well as our communities. And so I think when we look at crime prevention, it's understanding the levels of isolation that a lot of our communities have experienced in working through the pandemic. And so I think looking at ways that we can connect with both our youth and our communities and coming together. We're hearing youth say, you know, I miss my friends, but they don't even know. Think about developmentally, you have kids who have not been around their peers for several years. So it's like, I miss my friends. I miss that level of connection. And unfortunately we see here in the work that we do here at YouthSpark that there are individuals who are banking on these children and our community members being lonely. We're seeing high levels of exploitation, you know, whether it's from our perspective and working with youth, but also for the elderly members in our community. There are individuals who are capitalizing off of that loneliness. So I think us doing our parts and checking on a neighbor, checking in and just seeing how people are doing, seeing how we can be of assistance to one another and just trying our best to build that connection again. And I won't say to get it back to how it was because we still had some work to do before. So maybe we can get a fresh start and do this thing completely different and truly reach out to our neighbors and be there for one another.
Well, thank you guys both for that answer. That really just tied in the overall message of this campaign beautifully. It is on all of us to prevent crime in our neighborhoods. We all have a say. We all have the power to shape our communities into what we want them to be. We do just have like 2 minutes left. So if you guys have anything additional to share, go ahead. If not, I can wrap this up.
I'll just say that, you know, I just charge everyone in the community to try to do something. I mean, it's great, like doing webinars like this is great, but who are you sharing it with? If you are not doing something, reach out to your local police department, see what programs they have going on, see how you can get other youth involved. There's always something going on, but you have to be the person that takes that step to get closer to what we would like to see is much less crime in our communities.
Awesome. Well, I thank you both for being here so greatly. You guys shared a lot of really insightful things. Again, to all of our attendees, feel free to visit ncpc.org/preventviolentcrime to see what the 5 things are that you can do today. And other than that, if this webinar will be uploaded to that landing page as well. So if you want to view it later, send it out to anybody, feel free. But again, thank you to both of you and thank you for attending.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And our next webinar will be on May 31st, and that one will be aimed at business owners' role in this reducing of violent crime. So be on the lookout for that. All right. Thank you.